Aye.
Okay, so All right. So I'm reading. So thank you guys to come up to this session. So without further ado,
hello, are you? Is okay
with
you? Yes. So can you share your screen?
Yeah,
just tell me if you can do what you need, what you want, and I will help you if needed.
Great.
Yeah. Can you see my screen and my
screen now?
Can you hear my voice also?
Yes, I can hear your voice, perfect. Of course, yes. And I can see your screen.
Okay.
Yes, perfect. Do you need anything else?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's perfect.
Hello.
Okay, so I let you manage this.
Yeah.
Good luck to talk.
Okay, thanks. So, yeah, so let's get started. Hopefully you guys can see my screen and hear my voice. So first of all, my colleague Maki have present about how FMS can help on your microservices architecture. And now in this session, I will try to basically step by step to show you how our FMS react and how our FMS can help you in such a business context, to give a business context on your microservices architecture. So now you can see my Kubernetes. Now my Kubernetes cluster, so I will go to my cluster and we will start from this one. So let me run. Okay, so we are now on the screen of the console for us to create a few component here. So first of all, we will use our API gateway and our my FMS and our micro gateway. So you can download or you can try this product on our Docker Hub software engine. So the whole component that being used on this session is component. So after this session, if you interesting to test or to explore, you can download and run on your environment. So first of all, let's go to the our namespace here. So now before the session, I have created a new namespace which name is FMS, and let's see what's there. So we will start with none of deployment or services being deployed. So we start with zero component, and the first requirement is because we understand that your organization might already have a service mesh, so we will our component will work together as complement to the service mesh and give the business application context in your application. So we'll try to check if our Istio service mesh is already injected. So yeah, so what I've done is create the new namespace at mesh and set the Istio injection name. So we will start from this step to the next step. Yeah. So first of all, we will create a deployment for the IPA gateway, or WebMets IPA gateway, which you can download and explore and try from, you can download it from our Docker Hub, software ready. So I just create the API gateway deployment, and I will expose all the services. So this is the first, is there is API gateway host. So this is kind of like the part of how the internal communication between the our FMS micro gateway and the API gateway. Okay, this is the we are exposing the external API gateway. So for the step, we will go to the API gateway and we will take a look how we extract the microservices that already there, and then how we push the business context policy. So yeah, I think I have a connection problem here. As you can see, it a little bit slow because the environment that being used for this workshop is on our corporate cloud. So I need to connect to VPN. So this slow connection is kind of like a bit slow, and maybe kind of like, it's not as expected, but that I try my best. So hopefully there is no connectivity issue, so we can smoothly do our So now I have deployed the API gateway and exposed those what so we can connect. So let's try to find out if our gateway is. Try to find out what port, so try is the gateway already started or not. Yeah, it's still process started, so yeah, it's been starting up. So let me show you, and we will go back to this console again. The gateway is started. So this is the our gateway. As you can download previously, really I said you can download on our software ID Docker Hub. So let me go back again. So what need continue is we will I will do this as easy as I can, so you can see the point when we go to the app mess. So it may not be kind of like your practice in your organization, but we will more than focus on the app mess. So we'll deploy two microservices manually, and then we will enforce this business context policy to those services without changing our services code and without changing on the service mesh itself. So this is the Okay, I think this will be. Give me a second. So, I think there is issue when from this console. So I try to do on my PuTTY side. So I just deploy two microservices. One is named catalog, and the other one is named inventory. And I will do this on my PuTTY because I think there is an issue when doing this. I just expose the service of services for those microservices. As you can see, let's see on the there are another two beside the API gateway. There are another two microservices named catalog and named inventory, and also there is a new two services. So named as MSR desk catalog and MSR desk inventory. That the type is not bot, which is required for our app masterwork. So the service or the microservices that can be API file. So I will back to those terminology API file. So the type of the microservices that can be enforce the policy into it without required changes or any code update on those microservices is required to expose as a not bot type of the service. So now we have done for the environment. So there's API gateway and there is a microservices to be enforced by a business context policy. So let me go to the API gateway and try to configure the API gateway to understand which microservice that can be extract and then deploy the micro gateway, and those micro gateway will enforce the policy that we set up on the controller of on the API gateway. So yeah, as you can see, I'm logging into the API gateway. Sorry. So yeah. So now we have, as you can see, we have no API. We didn't put any global policy on it, which is gateway. We have three types, three level of policy, which is one is global policy, The next is the API policy itself, and the third one, the more deeper one, is the API scope policy. And for this demo, we will use the API policy and the API scope policy. So as on the app mesh, we didn't see any microservice at all. So I will configure the Kubernetes cluster. So what required is the kubeconfig file. It required for the app mesh to extract the microservices. So which is I already have it. So as you can see, I can on the previous console, I already download it as this one. So yeah, so this is the config file, and I will put the necessary configuration. So this is the service name, the internal one that we deployed on previous console. And then this is the micro gateway. You can download on our Docker Hub and put to your public public account on the Docker Hub. So I will set the port to 7071, and then the namespace that we are using is Atmos. So yeah, now we are done. We save this one. Okay, the configuration is already successfully, and let's go to the Atmos tab. So now we are seeing a two microservices on our infrastructure that where I said that this should be exposed as a not port type. So from this step, we can check that the not port is given by the Kubernetes this port, and then the endpoint of the microservice itself is default. So what the next step we have to do is we do the API file, because we believe this API have the specification, right? But we cannot see the specification of this API because there is only a really few detail on this one, only the port itself, and there is no regard kind of like a business context on the or the specification context. So what we need to do is to API file this one. So when we do the API file, we can see the API gateway will create a new API name. So the name is MSR inventory. So as you can see, this is the API without any resource or method that we will enrich this information, because we believe we have those specification on our team. And I will also API file this another one. So now we have two services here that already API file. So from this standpoint, we will enrich the specification, and then next we will put the policy context on into these microservices. So first of all, I will go with the MSR catalog here. Okay, it's so now what we have to do is I will update the contract itself. So there are two types of the contract to be updated. Is one is when we deploy the schema, which is Open API, RAML, and Swagger, and also the another one we can do it manually if we don't have those schema. And for this one catalog, we will do it import those schema, and the another one we will do it manually to create the specification of those API. So I will update this one. I will just quick, and we can see there is two method, two resources here. First is catalog with two method, get and post, and then another one is one resource named catalog slash ID with only one method of this resources. So yeah, we now have the specification. So we will go to the policy enforcement. So before we go to this policy enforcement, I will try to test this one. So I have time, so I will test this one before we do the. Let me prepare so we can check we can test before we do the policy enforcement. Yeah, so yeah, this is the catalog. The port is the node port from the Kubernetes. So we will try first. So you can see the response of the microservice. There is items with for each item there is a variation, and then on the second resource we can check the detail of those catalog ID. So yep, so this is as is, and then for the inventory we will check this also. There is an ID, there's a catalog ID there. So this is our microservices that are running. So next we will go to deploy the policy. So after we put the specification, then the policy what we want to do is first is we want to monitor those microservices, and then the second one we will create a scope. So previously you see that there is a catalog with a lot of variation, but to save the time I'll say okay, it will be, you can choose on the scope, is it per resource or only for a method of this resource. So can put to what the policy need to be enforced. So in this case I will to use the catalog get. Okay, then we will go to the policy, and then what we have, what we will to do on this one is we will try to first is we will mask this API. Previously we see there is an item and there is variation which is on the catalog. We try to let's say you not yet done with the GraphQL, so we just remove the variation of the response. Okay, then it's done. So we will remove the variation from the catalog response, and then second one I will do the throttling. So what will it do is if there's a request more than 4 in interval 1 minute, we can say there is too much request. This use case is pretty true. Let's say when we connect to other third party that have a concern on connectivity, or we are connect to our legacy system that have also concern on connectivity. So yep, on this application we can see the any consumer, and we just want to check the throttling mechanism itself, so we will ignore, but this is required for the configuration. So now we have configured the policy. First is there is a throttling mechanism, which is the throttling only for request count in 1 minute that load, and then the second one we will mask the item variation filter. So what next we will to do is we will go to the app mesh and go to the catalog microservice, and we will do deploy. It takes a few seconds to done deploy. So and then let me go back to the how does it happen on the Kubernetes side. So Yeah, so you can see previously there are two containers for this pod, which is our microservices and Istio Envoy proxy. And then there is now, after we deploy, there is another one pod, which is our micro gateway, will enforce those policies. Okay, I think it's already running. So we will do the test now with the Postman again. And how see, so this is the previously test without any enforcement policy that we send up. There are two enforcement policy. First is we will remove this variation, okay, on the catalog resource. And the other one is there is kind of like a throttling for this microservices. So we do have a lot of kind of like this rule and context like circuit breaker and so on, but for now we take this two types of rule. So without changing on the side of the client, then we will try again. So as you can see now, the app mesh really give a context of the business to the microservices without any changing code. So it removes the variation. It depends. So it expects that to know the variation, the consumer application needs to go to the specific catalog ID. So it save a lot on network transport, yeah, regarding the size of the data, which is maybe the microservices already there, and we need to save those bit of data in the transport level. So, so yeah, it's already removed. And then the second policy is should be a throttling only 4 requests per minute. So I try to connect it as fast as possible to send a request. And now we expect when it reads more than 4 or 5 and so on, it the app mesh will say that there is too much request here with a code 429, too many requests. And the policy is working as expected. So this request will be open in such about that internal calculation. It should be about 30 to 1 minute. And then a consumer can invoke this service again. So it was, so we will see the analytic view because we want to analyze that invocation. So we want to understand what happened on our API, what happened on our microservices. So let's go to the analytics. Give me, it takes a few times here to load. There is no connectivity issue here because I'm using our corporate VPN. So yeah, we can see there is 8 invocation. We can see the trend and for folder process, we can customize this dashboard. But for now, we just use the as-is dashboard. We can see there is 8. There is this is about the status, and we can see there is a let me, there's a success process there when we took like we can define what time that the request is coming, what the payload being sent, what the payload be received, and what the operation or the resource method that being invoked. And then on the policy violation, we can say what the reason it's failed is because 429, it was because we have kind of like a throttling this you can see on this one, because I just set to monitor once rather than every time it's a policy violation error. So yeah, you can, so from our current microservice actor, we can reference to get more eagle view. We have visibility to whole across our microservices is in a one control plane here. So yeah, those three like policy enforcement, which is we try to transform the request and then put a kind of like a throttling mechanism, which is we have a lot of rule about that, and we try to analyze do the analysis of this API. So that's done for the first API. And the second API, we have now inventory. So we have done the API 5. So we're not doing this again. So previously on catalog, we put those microservices with the schema that we have. So now we take a different approach to define the resource and method manually, because I believe this is kind of like also a most common approach, because maybe the developer is not update the current documentation or any reason at all. So I will put the resource that there. So it just one inventory ID and with method get. So I will add this one, and API gateway will extract this ID as the parameter of the URL. And then what we do is first, like the same, we will log to have an analytic view of this API. And then the second one, the third one, we will what the use case now is, we want to give the context, like if this is kind of like an external application, then the result should be like this. If this is an organization application, the result should be like this. So it's kind of like a true use case, which is like our identity and our maybe like family identity. When we go to hotel, we just give them our identity, but when we go to the governance institution, then we need to give our all identity, like personal identity and then the family identity. So yeah, so it's kind of like we will give a different response from a different consumer. So we just put the log to be viewed, and then we need to put the to identify those application. We will use the basic one, so API key. So this is will show previously there's a question how to secure our microservices. So this our FMS and API gateway can acting like the middle one, which will authenticate. So it's not required for the microservices to do the logic of authentication, is this authenticate or not. But for now, it's because the FMS will looking to the API gateway. API gateway will be the source of truth, but regard to this trial, we cannot do kind of like a JWT verification or auth. So, but the idea is the same. So the FMS, the micro gateway FMS, will verify if this an authorized request to continue to the microservices or not. So there is no need to code about on the our microservices about how the mechanism of to authorize and identify is this request valid for this identifier, or is this request is authorized for this application. So yeah, so this is the we will put the analytic, and then it's only for the go. And then we will put because we want to different respond on for each its application. So let's say before this one, so I will back to create, let's say there is an external app. Okay, I will leave it as is. There is no strategy or anything. We have a lot of identifiers, so application is an abstract view of the identifier. You can put JWT out, you can put IP address and so on. And then I will create the organization app. So what API gateway give if will give you the identification. It's not for the authorization, but it's an identification, because it expected on the authorization we will use auth and so on. So another mechanism, but the objective of the concept of demo, it will be API gateway is the source of truth, whether it's API key, whether it's JWT and so on. So there is no code changes on our microservices to identify if the request is eligible or not. So let's go back to our MSR inventory. So yeah, it was missing. So I will again create this one. We'll try it as fast as possible. So it should be this one. Okay, and then we will lock those to for the analytic, and then we will verify the request. It will be the same with all the using schema. And then second one, we will give a different, let's say if this is from external, which is because this is trial, you can say like not or any kind of geofence, but for this demo, we say if this is an external, then we will delete a few, we will masking about a few detail of the request, which is be true, like we don't need to give some sort of information to the external application. So yeah, so let's overview. We have locked this one for analytic. We have put the authentication with API key as the identification layer, not for the authorization, but it will work the same because the concept is the API gateway will be as the source of truth, whether what microservices or on the current API gateway authentication schema use. So it will go like this one. And then we have put that if this is kind of like an external application, we will remove or we will mask a few confidential data. So yeah, we're done, we save this one. And what we have to do now is we will deploy this one again. And we will see on the Kubernetes reaction to check the deployment of our micro gateway is there. So let me go back again. I will use the previous command. Yes, as you can see, the inventory is now being injected. The micro gateway is now being injected from 2 containers to 3 containers, and the previous one will be dismissed. So let's give a few seconds, and then yeah, I think it's done. So now we will go to test our business context policy that being enforced. So we will go back to Postman. So now this is the first result without any enforcement. And then we have put the enforcement that there is a identifier, or maybe you can add another authorization, but the concept is true. API gateway will as the source of truth is this request is authorized or not, but we will use only the simple one API key. But the mechanism you can choose is log, and you can choose it all with the logic and or logic or and so on. Okay, we will test this one. So yes, we expect this one because we are not authorized, because already we put authentication and identity mechanism to the micro gateway. The microservice now need to be changed. So what we have to do is now is the request need to be authorized. So I will just copy from the API gateway the the API key for the authorize for the identifier, and I will put this one. So this will be the organization app, and I will copy another one. And this will be external app. So let's go with the organization app first. So yeah, it's expected the organization app is now being authorized. It eligible to invoke our microservices without any further kind of like a transformation, because it's our organization app. So it the customer have the whole let's say in context of the auth, the whole of the information as limited by the scope that customer being concerned. So and then we will use the external app authorization or identifier in this case. And we expect that this is also a valid one, but with a few confidential data will be must. Okay, so now what FMS give is, because it's not our organization application, right? It's a third party or maybe another e-commerce, and maybe we can put our context to which one is confidential, which one is able to expose to the third parties without any change on our code, and we can put our authorization JW2Auth, and API gateway will be as the middle proxy to be the source of the truth of the request across our microservices architecture. So yeah, that's all for my demo. Really nice to answer your question, then I give back to you guys. Yeah, so it's done. So I give back to the moderator, and if you have any question, I think we still have time, so hopefully I can address your question, and I'd like to encourage you to try explore our solution on the app mesh. It will leverage your microservices architecture and service mesh into the next step of to deploy a business context. So the changing of code of the microservices is minimum, and you can deliver faster, you can deliver a more sophisticated API to your consumer, your customer, and your business partner. Oh yeah, we have a question from Billy. Thank you, Billy, for the question. So thank you, and to attend the demo. So to make sure the request valid only with API key. So there is kind of like a configuration there. Let me open just a second. Yeah. So just to give you a perspective how it works. So on this policy, what being enforced is we just enforce with API key, right? So we have a lot of kind of like authorization mechanism, so you can kind of like combine this one with API key and JWT token, also API key and auth token with kind of like a logical conditional, is it and or is it or, so both is required, but the idea is kind of like a phantom out, what it's called, the theory of phantom authentication, right? So there is kind of like this API gateway or API gateway will be acting like, so from your application, like an auth, which is a reference, it's delegate from the customer, so kind of like a reference authentication. We need to transform this reference to the by-file loop authentication, right, to understand who is this customer, what is this application, and we can react to personalize the consumer application or the customer field itself from the API. So I just use the sample one, API key, which the being on the API key one, because on the our gateway, on the our Docker Hub, it's also only able to this one, but on the full product without trial, we can put like a JWT token. So all microservices will with FMS. So not the microservice itself will identify or authorize this request, but the FMS will authorize this request back to API gateway, which is API gateway as the source of truth. He has cage about the culture for the whole valid token or the whole identity of the where the request come. Yeah, I think it's been answered. So because I just put it on, so any identification will be. Yeah, you're welcome, Billy. So we still have more time, and encourage you to come into our GitHub, come into to our Docker Hub, and download it and try and explore this one. We love to hear your feedback on our community, and maybe we can you can have a more perspective on how our FMS can help your organization in, on scope of micros services in architecture. Hopefully, guys, you interesting on this demo, and yeah, we still have time for your question. Yeah, so it's been 1:20. So yeah, we are going to the last minute, guys. So I'm still here until 1:20. So if you still have questions, hopefully I can address those questions. Yeah, so now if no further question, really appreciate for your attending for this session. See you guys, and we hopefully this session is give you a perspective on how our FMS can help your organization on your microservices architecture and bring the context of the business and application into those architectures. So yeah, thank you very much and goodbye, and have a nice day. Bye.